The previous chapter focused on the description and classification of our observations. The dynamic chronology of observations can, however, be presented more transparently in a fault tree and an integrated process problem solution model. Causality always proceeds chronologically. Therefore, each problem must be triggered by a last negative influence in a chronological causal chain of the upstream process. This releasing final cause is directly related to the problem and can usually be observed and measured. In some cases, we can control this trigger to solve the problem. In other cases, we must analyze the chain of causes from the trigger that releases the problem via intermediate causes to the primary negative influence, the root cause, that we should control. It makes no sense to assume root causes and develop solutions without knowing the trigger. The hierarchical fault tree provides an elegant way to represent the chronological relationships between solutions, causes, problems, and their effects in a clear manner. This tool is typically used for incident analysis in safety-critical environments. Here, we place the solutions at the bottom, link them to the triggers of the problem that finally lead to the effects at the top. We will use this fault tree instead of the Ishikawa diagram to first select, order, and evaluate the information from our initial observations. Later, we will use the fault tree for root cause analysis to structure our findings on problems and their causes. Then, we will also chronologically break down the triggering causes, mostly over several levels of the hierarchy, into intermediate causes down to their root causes. The fault tree models the observations and assumptions from a problem-solving perspective and classifies them into their respective categories. Especially process owners appreciate this transparent overview to understand your first assumptions, the scope, and the complexity of an issue. Sometimes the project sponsor decides to implement valid solutions for quick wins right here. The representation of observations and assumptions in a process problem-solving model assigns the causal relationships to process components. The outputs of any business process are repeatedly created material or immaterial objects, like our cookies or the shopping list, with specific attributes. Their creation requires inputs that also can be material, like the ingredients and the tin in our bakery, and immaterial information. Typically, the input is supplemented by a task that specifies the output object and its attributes. Digital, manual, or mechanical activities transform the inputs to the output according to the task. This is the added value of the process. Please note, besides the transformation of inputs into outputs in creation processes, the transfer of objects is also relevant when we transfer an object from an input location to an output location. It does not matter whether we transport our cookies from the bakery to the customer or transmit data in a wire. Also in this case, value is created by changing an attribute, the location of the object. In business processes, the transformation of inputs to outputs is rarely accomplished by a single activity. In our bakery, we could observe our chef, for example, mixing the ingredients, shaping, then baking the cookies, and finally delivering the tin with the cookies. Each of these discrete activities in turn requires an internal or external input and transforms it to an intermediate or final output by changing or adding attributes. In a Six Sigma project, we distinguish three different resolution levels of our perspective on the process. First, identification of the project topic. To identify the project topic, we first focus on the critical output as well as the first required inputs. By this delimitation, we determine the project field with all the summarized activities in between: ingredients, baking, cookies. Second, identification of relevant intermediate outputs. To identify the relevant intermediate outputs, which may themselves have problems, we divide the overall process into 8 to 12 core process steps, with respective inputs, activities, and outputs. Third, identification of the negative influences on the problems. To identify the triggers of the problems, we structure the core process steps in detailed input activity output units to detect all the negative influences that trigger or amplify our problems of the outputs. Please note, in any perspective on a process, from its macroscopic summary to its microscopic resolution, the input activity output structure remains the same. Depending on the perspective, the problems of a preceding output object switch the role to an input and become the negative influence of the same object on the following process step, even if the supplier of the output is identical with the customer of this input. Each activity is executed by resources, for example our chef and the oven. Other resources support the execution, for example the calendar, timer, the kitchen scales and energy. Resources can be machines, equipment, tools or other devices and utilities. But even the best resources alone do not add value by the activity being executed. We need guiding methods that determine how the resources should execute the activities. In our bakery, for example, these are a recipe, kitchen standards, operating instructions for our equipment, and the expertise of our chef. Methods can be any digital or analog instructions, procedures, algorithms, expertise, or habits that guide the resources. Please note, methods bring intelligence to any process. Many professional activities are guided by personal habits and preferences. This happens if there is no standard, the standard is unknown to employees, is too complicated, its benefits are not seen, or its application is not exemplified. This is unthinkable, for example, in air traffic, even if a pilot has already completed 5,000 flying hours. Lean principles recommend guiding repetitive processes by a commonly developed and accepted best practice standard, like a recipe for cookies. If no method at all is defined, then employees follow their personal preferences. Inputs from internal or external suppliers are explicitly or implicitly checked by the bakery with regard to quality, availability, and consumption. The bakery is in the role of the customer here. Switching the role to a supplier, the bakery provides the cookies, which the customer then checks as well. If input resources, methods, and activities have only the required positive influences, then specified outputs result. The deviation of the output in at least one important attribute is a problem. This output problem can only be caused by a negative influence of the upstream process, for example, the ambivalently formulated order, or by other negative influences of inputs, methods, resources, and activities. Please note, do not accept errors, avoid making errors, do not transfer errors. Masaaki Imai recommended this principle in 1991. The practice in some companies, however, is different. Especially if it is an internal supplier-customer interface, often unsuitable inputs are accepted and delays are compensated as far as possible in the own process. This is understandable in the short term to meet deadlines. In the longer term, however, this behavior prevents the supplier from knowing and solving the problem of his or her output. According to a personal survey, employees use between 10 to 25% of their working time to deal with inadequate inputs to carry out their processes properly. It is necessary to distinguish problems from their effects and causes from their solutions. In practice, these boundaries are sometimes blurred, and this has a negative impact on the project. Effects of problems, such as dissatisfaction and costs, represent the potential of a project and are therefore important in the evaluation and selection of the project. In the project itself, however, the problems are solved first by identifying, describing, and evaluating them. Then the causes of the problems are analyzed. Confusion arises if the reference to a non-existing solution is regarded as a cause. Please note, the use of negations in causes are quite common. They already present conclusions from observations that point to a desired solution. We expect that there should be a cookie cutter in the kitchen and indicate that there is none, and might note, chef did not use a cookie cutter. And then, in a circular conclusion, a solution is suggested, use a cookie cutter. Here, the absence of a solution is interpreted as a cause of the problem. And this justifies the implementation of the opposite of the negation, cookie cutter, as a resource for our activities. Only observable and thus measurable negative influences are candidates as interface for solutions, which then adjust, circumvent, or eliminate these causes. Thus, the mechanism of the integrated process problem-solving model is solutions, causes, problems, effects. This logic is represented in the DMIC, the phase model for our project. First, however, let us look at the statistical side of Six Sigma as a performance indicator.